Hi, welcome. It's Kenny Russell, Bulldozer Faith, Living Life in the Spirit. We're here on the Planting Seeds of Light tour in the USA and having some fun traveling across the country. And today I'm in Utah and I'm with Brad Scott.
Utah.
Brad.
Welcome to Utah.
Yeah, how are you?
Cold?
No. Cool. You probably need to keep that mic a little closer
Yeah, yeah, we're always cold here in Utah, so that's just the way it is.
Yeah, well, thanks so much for taking the time to meet with me. Heard a lot about you as I travel. You've been around. You know, I actually thought when I was going to meet you, you'd be like 160 or something, you know.
Instead I'm 25, right?
But awesome, Brad. But thanks for coming. I appreciate the time, you know, within your schedule and your traveling. I know you're checking out of town even again today. But tell me a little bit about your life, Brad. Where did all this start? Because over breakfast this morning, you shared that you were actually the pastor of traditional church.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Rather than going back to when I was born in a cabin, you know, and so forth, we'll start there. I've lived here. I'm from Missouri, but I've lived here for 33 years. Uh-huh. And the first part of those were spent being a regular pastor dude is the word that I use in a non-denominational church here in Vernal, Utah. And I was trained like most pastors are, you know, New Testament originally written in Greek, Old Testament originally written in Hebrew and Aramaic and so forth. And so I taught from that perspective. I had those glasses on because we all have those glasses on. And so I taught the traditional things. And until I had an opportunity to get a hold of the Dead Sea Scrolls and read some of the commentaries on the Dead Sea Scrolls. I mean, other New Testament historians who had an opportunity in the early 80s to actually see the Dead Sea Scrolls. And when they did, then later on, they started writing articles saying things like, well, now that we've seen the Dead Sea Scrolls, we think it's possible that the New Testament may have originally been written in Hebrew. Now, that fascinated, that really fascinated me because when I read, because I was trained in Greek, because when I read my Bible, my New Testament in Greek, I didn't see that well-defined, my big fat Greek wedding kind of Greek. I didn't see that. I saw something that contained a lot of redundant conjunctions and things and a lot of things that were so typically Hebrew and so untypically Greek. And that meant a lot to me. That changed things to me. Now I could see that what I'm reading is a translation of a translation, if you will, of a translation. And being trained in the background of the field of linguistics and so forth, I knew that any linguist will tell you that anytime you translate from one language to another, it's not necessarily a worldwide satanic plot.
Right.
It's just the nature of translations. You're going to lose some, a little bit of the passion and the meaning behind the words. And so I started just pouring myself into Hebrew. I mean, I took a Hebrew class, a couple of them in seminary, but you know, they didn't focus on that. So I started pouring myself into the language. Then I realized that there was an ancient aspect of Hebrew as well that contained these little pictures and so forth. And then pretty soon I began to realize that the Bible was actually designed for little kids to understand. They weren't, the problem was the adults. And that it wasn't really designed for adults. And that's the reason why Yeshua said, if you want to enter the kingdom, you must become as a little child. And so I began to realize that when you take the language of both testaments back into these ancient, simple, little childlike pictures. Oh, how much more simplistic life is.
Wow.
Because it's very complicated now, as you well know. And so I started teaching this to the congregation that I was pastoring. And as you have already experienced in your years of ministry, they weren't quite as happy and delighted about this as I was. as a matter of fact, the reaction was just the opposite. And so one day, this is back in the 80s, I decided that I wasn't getting this explanation of who Paul was, for example.
Right.
Wasn't getting that across to my congregation. My congregation. We still use those words. I wasn't getting that across. And so I knew I had some drama in school and so forth, and I thought, I'm going to write a one-act play, and it's going to be Paul in full makeup. Full costume or clothing, if you will, full makeup. And I'm going to do a one-act play in which Paul's responding as if Paul was in America today. And he's looking out over not just the church, but Hebrew roots, Messianic Judaism, as if you will. And he's reacting to what he sees happening today. And so I wrote the script and I did it as Paul, and it was a totally different reaction.
Wow.
All of a sudden, it's the gospel. Now, if you know, whether it was just Brad,
right,
our local pastor before, and now
it's his opinion.
That's
yeah.
right. Yeah, yeah. It's just Brad up there, and we know Brad because we see Brad, you know, do normal things in life all day. And so, you know how that goes. And so, for some reason, Paul held some weight, and things began to dramatically change. People said I should get a website. I just happened to get on the internet because I've been in this walk since '83.
Wow.
I just happened to get on the internet with a website when the internet was not a household, wasn't even necessarily a household thing yet.
Right.
And I got up there very early, and people started asking me to come and speak, putting articles up there and so forth. First started in Canada, and then it came to the United States, and it's just gone nuts ever since. Just spoke in my 39th country. I would have never guessed.
Wow.
40 years ago, playing in rock bands, which is what I did for a living 40 years, I would have never guessed that I'd be doing.
Wow.
Sitting here with you.
Wow.
Right I would have never guessed that.
That's incredible. So there you do. You deliver this whole thing on Paul. All of a sudden, people start to hear, and they now have ears to hear mm-hmm. the message of Paul. What would you say, just very simply, you know, we have a lot of people who are coming into Hebraic Roots for the first time, and they are really challenged. You know, what would you say is one of the most challenging things that's misunderstood about Paul's writing?
From a
Christian perspective.
Yeah, yeah. I think probably what's misunderstood most is revealed in Romans chapter 9 when Paul talks about how much he loves his own brothers in the flesh. And that he would give up his salvation, which is his way of saying his life.
Right.
He would have given up his life for his own brothers in the flesh. And I think because of that little innocuous kind of statement there, the reason why they don't really see that is because they don't realize that, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1, Paul said, I'm following the Messiah.
Right.
He says, follow me as I follow the Messiah. So right there, you know, Paul's not making anything up. Right there, you know that this is not Paul taking a new direction, going a different place, that he just told us that I'm following what Yeshua did, and Yeshua told us that I'm doing what the Father told me.
Right.
I say nothing or do nothing outside of what my Father told me to say and to do, and Paul's following that. And so because he's following Yeshua, he knew that Yeshua said, take up your cross and follow me, and that Yeshua said to his own brothers in the flesh, which was his brothers in the flesh as
right.
well, that you honor me with your lips, but your hearts are far from me. And so that's the foundation, I believe, of everything that Paul is going to say
yes.
in all his letters, is knowing that if his brothers do not have a relationship with the one who wrote the Torah, if they do not have that deep-seated personal relationship with him that drives his brothers to want to please the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then they're going to perish.
It's powerful because even at Romans chapter 1, what does he say? You know, he is a servant. He says mm-hmm. that he is an apostle of Yeshua HaMashiach, but he is a servant. He's not seeking to deliver his own will. He wants to deliver the will of the Father. And I think mm-hmm. when people get to the understanding of realizing what servanthood is, it means we don't come with our own opinion. And I think today we've lived in a world where we have so much expression of, you know, whatever feels right for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if this is how you see it, well, that's good for you.
Yes.
you
yes.
know what I mean? Type
oh, yeah. Yeah, I've heard
approach
that
to the,
yeah.
the scripture.
That's okay if you want to do it. That's good for you.
yeah. Now, when it comes down to, you know, salvation, how do you see salvation from a Hebraic perspective in comparison to how the Christian world sees salvation?
Well, first of all, as a trained pastor before that, I probably held the traditional view that everything about being a child of God, everything about being a son of the Most High, everything about being a Christian was based on one day in my life somewhere
right.
in the, you know where I'm going with this,
yep.
somewhere in the past, either something dramatic happened or something, but there's a date I could pick in my past in which I gave my life to Yeshua. And I definitely can say I gave my life to Yeshua. That is an absolute fact. But I assumed that everything had taken place right there.
Right.
And there wasn't anything else to do. And I understood the concept in typical Christian thinking that your entrance, your redemption into the kingdom and so forth is your salvation. And those two are, I figured out over time, are not the same terms.
Right.
Being saved is not the same thing as walking your life out in the kingdom and so forth. It's not even necessarily connected to born again, because there's a difference between a conception and a birth,
right,
and so forth. And I assumed that when I gave my heart to Yeshua, there a birth took place, when rather a conception took place, and so forth. And so there was a process. And the other thing I think that would differ is, I'm not saying that redemption into the kingdom, or reconciliation into the kingdom, is believing in Yeshua plus
right.
something else.
Right.
No, because when Yeshua hung on that tree and he said, tetelestai, he said, it is finished. He indeed was saying, there's nothing you and I can do to add to what I'm about to do. I'm going to die on that tree. I'm going to be buried into the ground. And he compared it to a seed, right? Unless a seed goes into the ground and falls into the ground, die, cannot bear fruit. He was saying, everything you need to enter into that kingdom, I did for you. Do not add to what I just did. Do not take away from what I just did. But Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians 15 that if Messiah didn't rise from the grave, produce fruit. This is what my ministry is all about, is
right.
house, family, piece of land, the simple things of life. And so Yeshua always compares these things to what's going on in the field. That's why he said the field is the world. And so if you plant the seed, but it just stays in the ground and dies, it can't produce fruit. He's not saying the seed dies as if it's dead. What he's saying is it's got to separate. That right. hard outer shell on that seed has to separate from the living embryo, burst forth from the ground, and produce fruit, because in the fruit is where the seed is.
Yes, amen.
And so a fundamental difference to me is the idea of keeping the Torah, the idea of keeping his instructions and commandments, isn't what got you into the kingdom. It completes the cycle of life, because yes. if you don't produce the fruit, then the seed does not propagate.
Right.
Plain and simple.
No, it's powerful when we realize that, you know, we're not out trying to tell people, if you say this prayer, you know, you go and you buy your insurance, now here's your assurance, and everything's going to be okay. Mm-hmm. We have to have the life of the Spirit. We have to have the fruit of the Spirit operating within our lives. And that comes by walking in his ways. So mm-hmm. salvation is a free gift that we receive from the works of Messiah.
That's
hallelujah.
Right.
And people are challenged, and they feel almost like they want to put a wall up when people say, you have to follow Torah. Because their concept of following Torah is the Torah is the law that kills.
Mm-hmm.
How do you deal with people with those type of statements when they say that, coming back to Torah, and they're afraid of that concept?
Yeah, I believe it's a misunderstanding of Paul once again.
Right.
You know the old phrase, you know, I'm afraid we're going to raise a whole generation of young people that think that Paul's first name is but. You know, but having said that, another misunderstanding of 2 Corinthians chapter 3, when Paul talks about the difference between the letter and of the Torah and the spirit of the Torah, the letter killeth and so forth. And the assumption is that it's talking about the commandments in the scripture. But in Hebrew thought, you know, the people that wrote the Bible.
Yeah.
In Hebrew thought, the idea of the letter of the Torah is the black letters on the white scroll, no relationship. You're just looking at black letters on a white scroll. That's called the letter of the Torah. Mm-hmm. But when there's a relationship with the one who wrote the Torah, and traditional Judaism will teach you this, rabbinic literature will teach you this, if you have a relationship with the one who wrote the Torah, now that's called the spirit of the Torah. And so you're keeping the instructions of the Father, because he's your father now. There's a relationship. You're a son. He's a father. And that's called the spirit of the Torah. But traditionally, in traditional Christianity, they teach that the letter of the Torah is the commandments of God.
Right.
And the spirit of the Torah is the grace of Jesus in the New Testament. But those are familiar idioms in Hebrew. They're not something that we can just make up. the difference in Hebrew thought, the ones who wrote the commandments, and or excuse me, the ones who penned the scriptures, is that the letter of the Torah is no relationship, and the spirit of the Torah is relationship.
So when people are talking about, you know, we've just got to have more of Jesus, you know, it's all about Jesus, and their whole focus is Jesus. How do we bring people from that concept to seeing him in a new light? Because really, we do have to change how we see Yeshua, don't we?
Oh, yeah.
We have to change, because it's not just about looking to Jesus. You know, like, you know, one of the things I was thinking about just the other day, repentance. Mm-hmm. Repent of your sin, receive Jesus.
Yes.
Right? Now you're saved. But the problem is, repentance, teshuvah, means to turn around.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't mean that our focus is on the sin.
Right.
So where is our focus? Our focus has to go back to the Torah. Can you explain a little bit more what that means,
yeah,
to see Yeshua through Torah and that sort of concept,
right,
to turn, you know, to come to Yeshua, to repent,
sure,
to turn?
First word out of Yeshua's mouth was the first words out of Yohanan the Immerser or John the Baptist's mouth. They both said the same thing to the same group of people. And one, and the reason why I quote those two is because John the Baptist was there to prepare the way,
right,
for the coming of the Messiah. And he came in the spirit of Elijah, which was to restore all things. Elijah's ministry was the restoration, Matthew 17, 11, of all things. And so the very first things that are said to the Pharisees, not the Gentiles. Repent, for the kingdom of God, or kingdom of heaven, same thing in Hebrew,
right,
thought, are at hand. And so what he's saying is to the Pharisees, who were supposed to keep the words of God, they were not supposed to add to them, they were not supposed to take away from them, they were supposed to maintain this throughout the generations. Mm-hmm. But they turned away and began to add things and rabbinic concepts and so forth, religious concepts, adding to the Torah, taking away from the Torah. And so therefore, they had strayed away from God. Therefore, they're honoring them with their lips, but their hearts are far from them. So the idea of repentance, I'm going to take it just a little bit further than you did.
Yeah, that's
the
fine.
Idea of teshuvah is based upon shuv, the root of that, which is found in its natural meaning in the opening chapters of Genesis. So then you'll understand what it means spiritually or symbolically later. That's the contention I have about with respect to my ministry. Every word in the Bible is revealed in the natural things in the beginning.
Right.
You can't start out with symbols.
Mm-hmm.
Got to start out with natural things. And so the first occurrence of shuv sets the tone for what Yeshua means when he says repent, mm-hmm, or John the Baptist means repent. And that is, from the dust you came, and from the dust you will teshuvah. You will,
wow,
shuv. So the Western definition, turn away from the direction you're going and go another direction. Nope. Turn away from the direction you're going and go back to where you came from.
Amen.
Amen. That's the concept of teshuvah, because if you're heading off a cliff and you take the Greek view, I'm heading off a cliff, I'm going to turn and walk off, go another way and walk off another cliff. And then turn and walk, yeah, up another cliff. And so
continually repenting.
Exactly. Continuing walking off more cliffs. The chances of you walking off a cliff from where you just came from are very remote and so forth. So the idea to the Pharisees is, I gave you these instructions. I told you the kingdom. You've wandered away from them. Repent. Go back to where you came from. Not, hey, we messed up with this whole Old Testament thing. We don't know what we were thinking, so forth. The reality is, we got a new plan. Now, I know I didn't tell you guys about it, and I'm sorry about that. And as, by the way, since I didn't tell you guys about it and you're not doing it, I'm going to call you hypocrites and snakes and vipers, because you're doing something, something's come that I never told you about. Why would he call them hypocrites, snakes, and vipers if he never told them,
right,
about this? The reason why he used those words is because they already knew that they were not to stray away from these things. And so therefore, he calls it. Why would you bawl them out if you never told them these things in the first place? And so this is what I would say with respect to what you said with repentance, to turn and go back to where you came from. And so later on, when the Gentiles have come to know Yeshua, and they start these assemblies, you get into the Corinthians now, the letters to the Corinthians. And now these Gentiles already began to be seduced.
Right.
Okay, beware of these things and so forth. And so now Paul's going to turn to the new Gentile believers and to say to them, repent. okay, because they had already started to turn away from these first things that they heard, sheep's and wolves' clothing, you know, wolves and sheep's clothing, you know, the whole concept. And so repentance is a word generally given to people to go back to where they came from.
When we look at the concept, you know, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, He was with God in the beginning. We look at that concept, we're talking about Yeshua. He is the Word that became flesh. How do we take that concept back to the book of beginnings? Because, you know, people get quite confused. I think a lot of people think that Yeshua came, and, you know, like you said, with repentance, it's taking you back to originally who we were called to be, getting back to His instructions, getting back to His root. But how do we identify Yeshua from the beginning? How would you see Him in the beginning?
First of all, a big part of my ministry is relating the spiritual concepts of the Bible, which people have a tendency to do, spiritualize everything, and forth, back to how the physics of the universe operates.
Amen.
Because it's my fundamental belief that everything is in the natural, everything in the symbolics is revealed in the natural, and that the Word of God brought everything natural into existence. And so therefore, they're going to constantly, the heavens declare the glory of God. They're going to be a constant picture and so forth of how it operates in the physical world. It's how it operates in the spiritual world. And so you have the Word of God becoming flesh is the same thing as E equals MC squared. For example, it's exactly the same concept. Energy, okay, can be converted into mass. Mm-hmm. And so the whole idea of the Word of God in the beginning is something you cannot see. It is energy. Fundamentally, it is energy. It is work. So if we're doing something, the whole Word of God is doing something. And that something took up on mass and flesh and walked among us. And so that now we can see how we are to walk out the Word with respect to Yeshua being there in the beginning. I believe that Yeshua was there in the beginning. I believe he is revealed as the Word, then He's revealed as light, and so forth. So He gives us, the focus is, He gives us all of these natural things in the beginning so we can understand symbolically or spiritually what that means to us a little bit later, rather than just seeing everything spiritually and failing to see the natural thing. So that's how I see the Word of God becoming flesh, and the whole bottom line of this is kind produces like kind.
Amen.
So therefore, the flesh can't be doing something different than the Word that brought it into existence. They have to be doing the same thing, because kind produces like kind. Apples produce apples, pears produce pears. The Word produces the Torah, or the Word, the Torah produces the Torah. Passover produces Passover. Passover can't eventually become Easter.
Right.
You see?
Absolutely.
And these biblical...
Ishtar.
Yeah, exactly. Because since it comes forth from it, you can't say it comes forth from it and it's a different thing. Mm-hmm. That's the way that our biological world goes. Otherwise, you have a mutation. Now, if you mutated the Passover, then you can come up with something that you say comes forth from that, but yet is totally different.
Right.
So the idea is Passover will always produce Passover. Shabbat will always produce Shabbat.
Amen.
Shabbat can't produce the first day of the week. Shabbat, because there's no first day of the week information in Shabbat. In the genetics of all these things is the same thing to produce. That's the whole concept of the seed, and that's the reason why the Word of God is the seed. Remember, Luke chapter 8, verse 11 says, the seed is the Word of God.
Amen.
You understand that? You understand everything.
Powerful stuff. Powerful. Now, you do a lot of work with young people, Brad. What are you seeing happen today with the young people within the Hebraic Root movement? What are you witnessing as you're traveling?
Well, I see a generation of young people who, number one, aren't, because of the internet, aren't willing to just accept the religion of their parents anymore.
Okay.
But that's the way it was for us back in the 50s and 60s, which is my generation in the 60s, the hippy-dippy days. And in those days, you didn't have the internet. You didn't have a way to communicate with everybody. And so, therefore, you just kind of took it for granted, you know, the things. When I went to when I went to church with my parents when I was young. And they should have taken me to church, don't get me wrong. But when I was their age, I didn't ask my parents for any evidence.
Right.
Yeah, I didn't say, I'm not going in there till you show me some evidence, you know, that this is true. You just went in there. And so all the things that you know now were just given to you. You didn't ask for any evidence and so forth. But then now we've got the internet, we've got YouTubes, we got all this blasphemous information as well, all over the internet. And so now the youngest generation are questioning, the current generation are now questioning. This is what I see not only in the United States, but all over the world.
Yes.
The youth in China are the same as the youth in Australia, which is the same as the youth in America. They are starting to question these things. They want to know, how do I know there is a God? They're not asking which day Passover starts.
Right.
They're not asking those questions. All the adults are doing that. But I believe the next generation, I'll cut to the chase. I believe the next generation is not seeking necessarily all the liturgy and all the rights and wrongs so much of how to do this and how to do that properly and how to start this properly. I think they're looking for something much deeper and from the heart than that. And I'm hoping that we'll be about the business of raising the next generation to seek after the heart of God.
Amen.
And not just the things that he does or the things he tells us to do, but seeking his heart.
Because that brings transformation, especially,
absolutely,
you know, when you look at things like the Shabbat, we look at the feasts, because the Shabbat is a feast as well. But, you know, the question is, what are we doing? Are we looking just into the system of the Shabbat, the systems of the feasts, or are we looking into the spirit, the life? But as you're going and you're ministering to the young people, are you seeing people desiring the walk of the Spirit, the life of the Spirit? Like, how do we see the life of the Spirit for Shabbat? You know, you might be watching right now and you go to Shabbat and you're all confused about what you do, you know, as you sit down saying, I have an appointment with the Creator.
Yes.
So here I am, you
That's
know.
Right.
I'm meant to meet with others, but, you know, you might be in an isolated place or whatever. But the question is, how do we embrace Shabbat? What does Shabbat look like to you?
I hate to be redundant, but it's very close to what you just said. I think sometimes we miss, in America, we use this phrase, and if you're familiar with that, okay, it means it went right over our head. I think sometimes we miss the whole point of Shabbat. As a matter of fact, if you read the instructions,
yes,
in the Tanakh concerning Shabbat, you're going to see very little instruction on exactly how to do something. I believe the Father is deliberate. I believe he is deliberately vague. Can I use that word?
Yeah.
I think he's deliberately ambiguous about a few things because he wants to see our hearts. He wants to see, instead of telling us, okay, you draw the line here and you stand here and wait till you draw the line there and so forth, or when you go out to do something, you're going to wear a red hat with a black shirt and so forth. And so then we, you know, should I limp on the way there with a black hat and a red shirt? You know, no, just get there. I don't care what you wear, okay? This is what I want for you. And I see the... Passover is the same thing. Pesach is the same kind of thing. Most of what we do at Passover is tradition.
Right.
And there's nothing in and of itself wrong with tradition. It's just that when you start saying, you know, it's a commandment and so forth, and your blessings and so forth, and when you start saying this is a commandment, now we've gone away from traditions, that if people aren't doing their traditions, in their eyes, they've broken the commandment. And so this is the danger of making something that's a tradition into a commandment. Then when they're not keeping the tradition, they believe you're breaking the commandments.
Right.
And so keep it. And so I believe the Father's deliberately vague because he wanted to see the test, if you will, or see is a better word, the individual hearts of his people, how they will, just with the idea that our Father said that we need to rest on that day just like he did, you rest as well. I think he wants to see our individual hearts and how we
respond,
appropriate that in our own lives.
You know, it's so important what you said there, Brad, because it's about relationship.
Mm-hmm.
It really is about his life, enjoying the life of the Spirit, to walk in his ways. You know, I look at Pesach last year and, you know, just as, you know, I'm only a few years coming into doing these things. We've done Passover for a number of years. My wife is Jewish. You know, we got rid of Easter a long time ago. But, but you know, how we did it, it was just like the Seder meal of the tradition. And now I'm actually more interested in how do I strip a lot of that stuff away and just really get to the heart of what is the Ruach saying at this time? How do we embrace this as a family at this time? How do we walk in the fullness of this feast day and enjoy the life of the Spirit in this feast day? You know, a lot of people think when you come into Hebraic roots that, you know, firstly, you must be giving up on Jesus. That's one of the things they say, because you're going back to Torah. And secondly, you know, you definitely must be giving up on the things of the Spirit because, you know, you're going back to the law. What's your experience as you're traveling? You know, what was the Father place on your heart that you minister as you travel? Because, you know, we do see a lot of people in Hebrew roots that have been, they've come from Spirit-filled environment. They start to find out about all this stuff, and it's almost like they dive into this sludge of information, knowledge, and become addicted. You know, it's like we have this addictive nature. I've got to learn. Revival, they all became Greek and Hebrew scholars. And now we look across the Welsh countryside and we just have, you know, empty, ruined buildings. What do you think happens to us when we come into these truths, and how do we encapsulate the Spirit so that we don't lose those things?
Yeah, there's a couple of answers to that. Number one is our local view, or our personal views of what doing something in the Spirit means.
Right.
And because I've had a lot of people in this walk have come in and out of it and so forth over the years that will say that, you know, that they came from that traditional background that you've talked about, very charismatic, very Pentecostal, which is my background as well. And so they started attending some of the Messianic synagogues and some of the Torah services and so forth. And they come out saying, I didn't see any Spirit. You know what I'm talking about. I didn't see the move of the Spirit there at all. Well, part of the problem, not all of it, but part of the problem is what they think the move of the Spirit, what they've been trained to believe the move of the Spirit is in the first place.
Right.
So in other words, some people walk in there, and if people aren't flopping on the ground, if not everybody's speaking in tongues, if chairs aren't flying, if people aren't dying of laughter or laying on their back on the floor, then the Spirit is not in the room. So we do have to consider that. That is part of the problem. But the other part of the problem, once again, is defining of terms. That's the reason why ministry has always been based upon what words mean things. What do the words mean? And I think people have a skewed view even of what law is, if I can take a moment. This is the reason why I take things back to their original meaning, not what they mean in a Brown Driver Briggs and a Strong's Concordance now, but what they meant when they started in the beginning. I call that the mountaintop meaning of the word. Uh-huh. As if you take water back to where it came from, it's pure, it's crisp, it's pristine, it's full of energy, and it's good to drink.
Yeah.
But we're understanding words way downstream and so forth, and we need to take them back to the beginning. Even with the word Torah, which you look it up in a Brown Driver Briggs, and it will say instructions. I mean, if you bother to go past what your pastor just said that morning, if you bother to actually look it up, as you go halfway up to the mountaintop, you're going to see it means the instructions of a father. Now we got some more information, right?
Right.
Okay, that's a little more personal. Father, son. Okay, but we're still not anywhere near the concept of law and Spirit and so forth in the Scriptures. We take it back to the roots Yara, Yod, Re, Hesh. And we take it back to its natural meaning. And it's the casting, when the clouds come over the land, and it casts forth the rain out of the clouds to the ground, that is Yara. That is the root of Torah and so forth. And so it's agricultural. Surprise, surprise.
Wow.
So the idea is that when the farmer plants the seed, because the rain, the commandments, the Torah, doesn't plant the seed, the farmer, the husbandman, remember, the father's the husbandman.
Yes.
I am the vine, you the branch. My father's the husbandman. The farmer plants the seed. The ground didn't do anything to deserve it. so forth. That's your grace. That's something the ground didn't deserve, looking at a field. But if the rains don't come, so the idea of the Torah is to rain down upon the land.
Amen.
And cause the and produce moisture in the soil, so that little hard shell of that kernel surrounding that living embryo falls away, separates, which is mute, death in Hebrew,
uh-huh.
which is what Yeshua meant. And now that living embryo begins to spring forth and produce much fruit, and there's another seed in that. So I think it's a misunderstanding of what law is, because law in America, there's even a famous song, I fought the law and the law won. I mean, that's a real famous song in America. I fought the law and the law won. So we've been trained over decades, albeit centuries, but particularly my lifetime, decades, to believe that the law is the bad guy. The law is this strict little set of codes and so forth that if you make one step over it, so forth, off to jail you go. And I think it's a total mm-hmm. misunderstanding of what the Torah is all about.
That's just beautiful what you said there. Just to picture that, how his Torah, his commandments, they come, they water.
Yeah.
They water us. You know, it's powerful.
Yeah. It gives us life and blesses. So it only, it blesses the ground. That's why the Bible says, if you obey me, I will bless you. If you obey me, the seed will get planted in the ground. No. Mm. Then no seeds would be planted in the ground.
Yeah.
Because nobody keeps all of his ways and so forth. And so the idea is, I gave you, I planted the seed.
Which is his word.
That's right. Which is his word.
Yeah.
Now these things will water it and cause it to produce much life.
Amen. Amen.
Torah is life.
It is
life. I mean, we know that. That's what it's all about.
Yeah. That's powerful. And that's what we want to encourage those that are watching today, you know, to find life. You know, Yeshua, he said this. He says, I am the way, the mm-hmm. truth, and the life. And he says, no one comes to the Father except through me. You know, there's something very powerful in that statement. There is mm-hmm. no other way to the Father except him. Now, we deal with the root of Jesse. We mm-hmm. deal with the Netzer, Yeshua rises up.
Mm-hmm.
The concept of there is no way at the Father is because there is no other living branch from the root of Jesse.
Yeah.
There is only one living branch that's coming up, that's Yeshua, and that's how we have to be grafted in. Brad, your ministry is Wild Olive, was it Wild Olive?
Wild Branch.
Wild Branch Ministries. When it comes to the grafting in process, how do people become grafted in? How do we have to see things to be truly grafted in to who he has called us to be?
Well, I think the first realization is that you have to understand that the tree you're in is not cultivated and it's not going to produce
right.
God's fruit. So I think the first thing, but that's part of repentance, if you will, as being grafted in. The first thing you have to realize is that the tree that I'm in is not a good tree.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, that tree needs to be rooted up, which is, I think, also part of a misunderstanding. The New Testament, Yeshua says, take up your tree or take up your cross and follow me. In reality, that was a tree. Uh-huh. Paul says it's a tree. He's quoting from Deuteronomy that says he was hung on a tree. And so the idea of taking up the tree, that same word is used for take up the mountain. If you pray, that mountain will be removed, take up.
Wow.
And so I think what Yeshua is saying is not take a cross and put it over your shoulder. Not that there's anything, you know, sensibly wrong with that. But I don't think he's saying take up a cross, put it on your shoulder, and walk around the world and talk to people. I think he's saying is that take up your tree, remove your tree, and come into my tree, the only good cultivated natural tree. And as you well know, the biggest, the reversal of those things that you see in the field is the problem, because in traditional Western religious systems, they teach that all the branches of the natural tree have to be grafted into the olive tree. And the reason why they believe that is because that's the way you naturally do it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if you're a farmer out there in the field, you're going to be naturally, you're going to be taking the good branches and you're going to be grafting them into the uncultivated tree to help it, to minister to it. But Paul says in Romans chapter 11, you're going to be grafted in contrary to the way it's normally done.
Wow.
In other words, the bad branches are going to be grafted into the good olive tree. So the first thing that has to happen, which is related to repentance, is to realize I need to turn from this tree that I am, because it will never produce God's fruit.
Right.
Only the natural tree. And of course, the other side of this is true as well, and that is Paul is also saying that if you're of the natural tree, now that you're born of the natural tree, but you don't believe, you're not producing fruit, then your branches are cut off.
Right.
Which means you're not producing the fruit of the natural tree, which means the seed cannot propagate from those branches because the seed's in the fruit.
Yes.
Genesis 1, verse 11. And so unless you produce the fruit of the natural tree, you can't produce the seed, propagate the seed of the natural tree. So they have the opportunity to be grafted back into their own tree. And that's why we have indeed, based upon partially on what you and I talked about this morning, we have to understand that when we are in Israel, we have a responsibility.
Yes.
To reach out to those branches that are laying out there in the dirt.
Right.
So they can be grafted back into their own tree. That's our responsibility.
It's powerful. When we look at the wild olive tree, you know, it's just reliant totally on the elements supporting it. And basically, you know, it's like it's trying to grab at everything possible for sheer survival.
Sure.
And that's a picture of us and our lives without Yeshua.
Amen.
In the right place.
Amen.
But when we come to him and we are grafted in, you know, the Father's a gardener, and we come and remain in the vine, what a powerful picture of seeing how the Torah will water, his instructions will water us. You know, Yeshua did say, he says, bear fruit in showing yourselves to be my disciples.
Amen.
You know, this is the whole key of where we've got to get to show ourselves to be disciples. You know, a bad tree can't bear good fruit. You know, there is such a challenge right now as more people are waking up to the importance of Torah, that Jesus didn't start the Jesus Christ & Co. Inc., you know, the new incorporation without the Father. You know, Father and Son, that business is closed. Now it's the Jesus & Co., you know.
Okay, never saw it that way.
Yeah, we have a new...
That's true.
We have a new way, you know, that's just separate from the old. You know, I had one pastor stand up and shout out in the middle of a service, we are not under the law, but we're under the moral law, you know, and making these statements. And I said to him, I said, look, if we're not under the law, I want to ask you a question. When was the last time you saw a rainbow?
Mm-hmm.
You know, did Yeshua just, or did the Father, did he just forget to take it down, you know? Because we're now in this new covenant with Yeshua, and all these covenants are done away with. Now, that's an important point. Dealing with covenants, Brad, I think people, they've been so indoctrinated to say that we're in the new covenant. I go out in the streets and I ask people, how do you know you're saved and stuff like that? And, you know, I had one guy on the beach in San Diego there, and he is just going crazy. He says, the covenant is the blood of Jesus. That's the covenant. And I'm looking at him going, you know, if you understood covenant, you wouldn't have said that, because the blood is what is used to seal the covenant.
Yes.
How would you see the covenant that Yeshua talked about? Because, you know, many people, they just prayed the prayer, they said the prayer. They never got told about covenant relationship.
No.
They, why am I saved? I repented. Mm-hmm. What covenant are we in with Yeshua? How do you see that?
It's always fascinating to me to see and hear the same thing, to pass by driving through a town. And, you know, virtually all churches have some sort of billboard or sign up in front, you know, we're a new covenant church and so forth. And wonder at the same thing, what in the world are they thinking when they think new covenant? Of course, the reality is pretty much how you described it, so forth. And I think one of the fundamental things that we fail to see in the new covenant, the obvious one would be, where does the word new covenant come from?
Right.
That would be the first thing that I would ask. I mean, if I was a student of scripture, I might say, where, because the testimony of Yeshua is the spirit of prophecy. Everything he's saying has already, and does, has already been prophesied. So when he does lift up the cup, and he does say, this is that new covenant,
the cup
sealed,
of my covenant,
ratified, if you will, in my blood, he's referring to something that was prophesied before that. So obviously, when you read the occurrence of the word new covenant, you're going to come to Jeremiah, and you're going to read there what is the basis of him hanging on the cross in the first place. So many people in traditional Western religions don't see the very reason for the new covenant being enacted in the first place, because the new covenant is only made with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Behold, I make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Two things that we know historically had been separated.
Yes.
And so forth over time. And so the new covenant was to bring them back together as one. So in John chapter 10, when Yeshua says that nobody takes my life, nobody takes my life. I lay it down for the sheep to make of two one fold with one shepherd. And so the whole idea of the new covenant is that according to the scripture, a kingdom divided shall not stand. And if we're going to succeed in this walk, if we're going to defeat the adversary, the enemy in all areas, we've got to be one, my friends. We can't be a divided kingdom. And the Father knew, because God is smarter than we are, the Father already knew that we and you and I, those of you watching us right now, would be living in these times when we have a real enemy now, in some ways, you know, not just a spiritual enemy, which some people can't grasp, and so they ignore it and just go on with their life because they don't see it. Now we have things knocking on our door, want to cut our heads off, all those kind of things. So now we have something walking in the flesh that if it's against a united kingdom, they're going to lose. And I'll tell you straightforward, no matter what the adversary's schemes and plans are, if he's facing a united kingdom of God, he's going to lose.
Yeah, absolutely.
But if he doesn't, the story changes, because this kingdom has got to be brought together as one. Because in order to have truth, witnesses have to agree. Mm-hmm. In order to have truth, you have to have two witnesses, but the witnesses have to agree. If the witnesses do not agree, then you don't have truth. And so the whole idea is to bring them together as one right now. And that's ostensibly what the new covenant is. So it's always amazing that you have a traditional Western church that says we are the new covenant, but we don't have anything to do with Israel and Judah.
Right, that's interesting. Yeah,
how could that be?
It's so true. I think, you know, when we look at the new covenant, I like to take a lot of people, you know, it's obviously Jeremiah 31, but I like to take them to Hebrews chapter 8.
So they can see it there.
Yeah, so they don't get confused.
That doesn't count. Yeah, Hebrews 8 counts, Jeremiah doesn't count. I understand that concept.
Yeah, you know what I mean? It's like, I can listen to what it says there, but go back to that origin of the covenant, and it's something different. So again, what you're saying there on this new covenant, Yeshua was referring back to the covenant. Why a new covenant? You know, like it does say that he will put his instructions in our mind and in our hearts. Mm-hmm. That's a pretty much foundational. And it says within that passage as well that when it was given to the children of Israel, they didn't believe. They weren't faithful. But the difference will be that we will believe this, that we will receive this with a heart of flesh. We will be able to partake of this. Do you think there is that there is power in those that are following in the Hebraic roots? Do you think we're about to witness an incredible move in this generation? What do you see as you're traveling? You know, you are getting a viewpoint as you go to the nations. You're sharing this message. What do you think is happening?
Well, I think historically that the manifestation of the gifts of the Spirit, and let's just put that with miracles, things of that nature, always follow the word. And you'll see this everywhere. When at Passover, of course, the blood on the door and so forth, and it's receiving the word of God in the Passover. First, that made them. It was sealed with the blood. That was followed with parting of the Red Sea and so forth. And all that happened with respect to receiving the word first.
Yes.
And so, therefore, the word became flesh, dwelt among us, and walked among us. And when they received them him in the New Testament, then Acts chapter 2 are followed with, here come the manifestation of the gifts and so forth. And of course, the reason why you see this historically, but repeated over and over and over again, is because of these three little words in the beginning. It only happens five times in the first 11 chapters of Genesis. It says, and men began. There's your problem. Once men start to do something, you can pretty much figure out within a couple of weeks, we'll mess it up.
Right.
And because it's the nature of men. we will wander away from God and we will do whatever we want to do. And next thing you know, nothing looks recognizable anymore. So the Father's always in the restoration business. He always has to restore things for just such a time as this. Because when men start to do something, they make a mess of it. So he's got to restore it. So we've done it for the past 2,000 years.
Yeah.
For 2,000 years, we have relied on theologians and so forth for 2,000 years. How many problems have they solved in the body of Messiah? Not a single one. We still divide over the same things in 2015 as we did in 15. It hasn't made one bit of difference for 2,000 years. I think our Father knew that because he's smarter than we are. And so he says, in that day, this day that we're living in right now, once again,
yeah,
he's restoring his word to us, he's not restoring organizations and fads, theological fads and so forth. He's restoring the written word of the creator of the universe in us, and that will be followed with signs. Amen. That will be followed with manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit back. Because if we especially as Hebrew roots people, we can't assume that traditional religious systems of today corrupted Passover, corrupted Sabbath, corrupted the dietary laws, and didn't corrupt the gifts of the Spirit.
Right.
I think that would be a false assumption. Well, they got that part right. No, I think traditionally man makes a mess of everything.
Yeah.
And I think that the Father wants to restore things back to the way they were. Get away from the untie my bow tie, who stole my Honda kind of thing, and go back to the way these things were manifested in the beginning. And part of my ministry is showing that, yes, even the gifts, all the gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 14 are in the Tanakh.
See, it's powerful. It does say in the New Testament, it says that the gospel was preached, you know, even back at Mount Sinai. I think it is important that we take the journey back and we start discovering, you know, the gospel that is preached through the Torah. Because some people get, you know, especially in the land of Israel, Brad, one of the things I see where Messianics are coming to the Hebraic roots, one of the number one assignment against them from other Messianics, if you come into Hebrew roots, you're going to end up back in Judaism.
That happens quite often.
Because I really believe the reason why that happens is they fail to see Yeshua through the Torah. They go back to the writings, they go back to the traditions, and like you said, man, it becomes the man thing. It becomes about our knowledge, what we can obtain. And I think one of the things that I really want you to capture as you listen today is the importance of, it's not about how much you know.
Yeah, that's right.
The question is, do you know him? Mm-hmm. Are you taking the time to get to know him, to come into fellowship? That when we go to the scripture, what we're going to the scripture for is to see him revealed so we understand more of who he is, not that we become more knowledgeable.
That's right.
Of what the scripture has to say. Brad, we've got, you know, 3 or 4 minutes remaining. You know, what things is the Father really placing on your heart right now that you feel that you're sharing? And just, you know, share with those that are watching just some of the key things that he's revealing to you this time.
This has been particularly true in the last 5 or 6 years. As I said, I've been in this walk for 32 years now, and I've seen a lot of things happen. I've seen a lot of changes in terminology. You know, back in the 80s, we were Hebrew Christians or Christian Hebrews and words like that. And then we went into Messianic, and then we went into Hebrew roots, and then we went into Torah observance. So I've seen all the little fads and all the little things come and go. I've seen a whole lot of people, as you said, went from the spirit of the Torah right into the letter of the Torah. I mean that they began to learn these things, and they were still they still understand Yeshua. They still understood the relationship, and they jumped right into the black letters written on the white scroll, and so forth. And therefore the relationship began to fade away. And I think, to me, the most important thing that we need, especially as adults, to be doing right now, is just in case Yeshua doesn't come next Tuesday, just in case all of our timelines are wrong again, we have a responsibility to raise up another generation, this next generation. Amen. We have young people, 13, 20, 22, 25 right now, who are questioning these things, and we need to be able to give an answer to every man that asks us the reason for the hope that is in us. And so ultimately, this is what the young people are going to be screaming out. A lot of the things that, that many of us have learned over the last 30 some odd years is not what they're screaming out for. They want relationship.
Yes.
They want to see a loving, kind God. They want to see mercy and grace operate in their lives. They want to see joy and peace as they walk this life out. They don't want to continually go to the tour services and see arguing and strife over things that are important and things that aren't important.
Yeah.
That's what I think is the most important thing that we ought to be doing right now is training up that next generation.
Amen.
To be able to propagate the seed, because the whole idea is of the seed is not just to produce fruit.
Yeah.
And it's not just for the producing fruit for the sake of fruit, but the seed is in the fruit, my friends.
Right.
And the seed is the word of God.
Yeah.
And so the whole idea is to go forth into all the nations, teaching them his commandments.
Yeah. To bring transformation. And that's amazing, because, you know, our heart as well is how do we get out on the streets? You know, there is so many people need to hear the truth. They need to hear this message. You know, I come from the UK. You know, we had the majority, I think we have less than 1% attend a traditional church.
Yeah, that's what
today.
I heard last time I was here. Yeah.
Why? Because they already left the building. They said, you know what? It's not here. There's just nothing here for me. I'm not going to go through this stand-up, sit-down, through the motions.
Mm-hmm.
And in America, you know, we're starting to see now even the turn here. Over 1 million people are walking out of the system every year, not because they don't want to follow Yahovah or walk in these ways, mm-hmm. but because they're like, you know what, I'm done with going through motions. There has to be a purpose behind it.
Right.
And one thing we want you to capture today, that this is time for us to rise up and get hold of vision, his vision. What has the Father called you to do? Do you have a word from him? You know, gone are the days where we look at our children and say, what do you want to be when you grow up? You know, we should train them to know the ways of the Father so that we can see a generation mm-hmm. that has an expectation Amen. That is way beyond what you think you could be or you could do with your life. What does the Father have for you? We are all born for such a time as this. We are born in this generation for mm-hmm. supernatural transformation. And what the Father has for us is far beyond what you could ever imagine you had
right.
for yourself. Mm-hmm. So we encourage you right now, as we've just shared today, we want to ask you right now to reach out and say, Father, what do you have for my life? Show me your way. As we come back to the Torah, allow him to reign on you with his blessings as you keep his commands, mm-hmm. as you are walking in his ways, as you follow the feast. This is the time for you to come to a place of supernatural transformation. This mm-hmm. is the day in which we are living. Brad, how can people get hold of your ministry materials, your website, and mm-hmm. Where do they go to?
Well, we are located at www.wildbranch.org. You can email me at brad@wildbranch.org. We are located in Vernal, Utah, and you can see us on the other networks as well. But the main thing, of course, is the website, and that will direct you to all the other places that you can go. We have a marketplace on the website. You know, the traditional books, CDs, DVDs, all that kind of stuff is there as well. Plus, there's hundreds of, you know, things that are recordings and articles that are absolutely free. There's no cost for that as well on our website.
Amen. Well, Brad, thank you again.
Yeah, you're welcome.
It's such a blessing to meet up with you. I've heard so much about you. I'm looking forward to what the Father has for us in the future, as you know, we're on a very similar mission to bring transformation to this generation.
Enjoyed every minute of it.
And I want to thank you for watching as well. Until next time, you're watching Kenny Russell Bulldozer Faith, Capture the Moment. Shalom.
Shalom.